That introduction, I will hand over to Abida. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Aip, for this introduction into the limbic system. When we are doing neurosurgery, not many of us actually try to delve into the anatomy of this region. It's complex to understand and the connections are very powerful. So you cannot exactly picture it and you don't see much of it during your surgery. So you're left to, you know, imagining it or using some three-dimensional perspective to understand this limbic system. So what we have done is we have analyzed the whole connections of the limbic system and the Papez circuit by fiber dissection. And I'm going to show you the various components and then we'll take it from there. Okay. John, should I start screen share?
Yes, you remember, right?
Yeah. Yeah, can you see?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. So here we go. So why do we consider the medial temporal lobe along with this? These three things are intimately connected. The limbic system, the Papez circuit, and the medial part of the temporal lobe. This is where, this is the most primitive region of our brains. And this is where, as I was saying, all our emotions and all our reactions come from. So let's look into that. Another thing before I start, why white fibers? Up till now, we have been thinking by this traditional theory that only cortical areas have eloquence. We've always heard about the Broca's area, about the Wernicke's area. We haven't paid much attention to the white fibers of the brain. And now in the last few several years, this has come into the limelight and it is now becoming essential to know the anatomy of the white fibers of the brain. So the limbic system, like any other part, has two components, the gray matter and the white matter. So we are going to look at both the components. Before that, I'll just give you a brief overview of the white fibers of the brain. So just as I said, now there is a concept of connectotomics. That is, both the cortex and underlying subcortical white fiber pathways are essential for function. And for neural plasticity, suppose you damage a cortical area. Maybe there will be another cortical area that will take away the function. But if you damage the subcortical network, nothing is going to take over that function for you. You have damaged it for good. So what I've recently published is, it's a complete fiber dissection study of the whole brain of both the cerebral hemispheres. And this is the effects of damage of all the white fibers, the major white fiber bundles in the cerebral hemispheres. And you can see some of these are components of the limbic system. Like you have here the cingulum. You damage this and you have behavioral and emotional disturbances. You have the uncinate. You damage this, again you have behavioral and emotional disturbances. Then you have portions of the corpus callosum and you are all very familiar with the various disconnections that you see when the corpus callosum is damaged. Here another one. This is a major connection of the limbic system. When you damage the anterior commissure, you will have behavioral and emotional disturbances. If you damage the hippocampal commissure, you will have memory disturbances. And if you damage the fornix, you will have memory disturbances. Mind you, all these deficits will be permanent because you have damaged the circuit. You have damaged the electric circuit that is going through connecting two cortical areas. So in this paper, what we did is we classified the white fibers of the brain according to their direction and depth into five groups. So there were four horizontal groups and one vertical group. The first one is the superficial group, which consists of the short association or the arcuate fibers. The middle group consists of the major long association fibers. You have the SLF, the arcuate, the ILF, the MLF, the uncinate, the IFOF, and the sagittal stratum. Now these two groups, the deep group and the central group, are going to be the focus of the presentation today, where you have, I call this the deep group because most of these fiber bundles are in the depth of the cerebral hemisphere and are in close relation to the ventricle. So you have the fornix, you have the stria terminalis, the stria medullaris thalami, the medial and longitudinal striae. And then you have the central group, which is made up of all the commissures. So you have corpus callosum, which is the biggest commissure. You have the anterior commissure, the posterior and the habenular commissure, and the hippocampal commissure. And this vertical group is that of the projection fibers, which consist of the internal capsule and the thalamic radiations. So we are going to restrict our discussion today to the limbic system and the papace circuit. This is just a diagrammatic representation on a specimen of all the five layers that I discussed. So this yellow circle here is the short arcuate fibers. This purple circle here is that of the long association fibers. Here you can see the cingulum that is part of the long association fibers. And you have the SLF, medial part of the SLF that is running above it. Then you have the central group, that this is the green circle, which is composed of the commissural fibers. And this is the red circle, is the deep group, which has most of the fibers of the limbic system. And the vertical group is this orange circle. And you can see this is the projection of the vertical group as the corona radiata onto the superior aspect of the hemisphere. So let's get on with the limbic system. This is the most complex and least understood part of the nervous system. It is also the most primitive. And it is, if you imagine the limbic system, as I will show you in the further images, it is a circle of seas. So you have the cingulum, it forms a series of rings. You have the cingulum, underneath that you have the corpus callosum, then you have the fornix, in between that you have the striae terminalis. So basically there is a system of seas that revolves and makes up the anatomy of the limbic system. What does the word limbus mean? It means border or margin. So earlier, evolutionary wise, it was seen that first this was referred to as the limbus because it was thought that this is a boundary between the cerebral hemisphere and the diencephalon and mesencephalon and the primitive brain. Broca in 1878 called it the grand lobe limbic. Then MacLean in 1949, he said that it's not just the cortical connections that are important. It is the cortical, subcortical, and their fiber connections that make up the limbic system. And by some silver degeneration studies, Nota extended the limits of the limbic system to include the midbrain. And now we have the papace circuit, which is the most integral component of the limbic system. So papace postulated that the anatomical basis of emotion was found in the hypothalamus, the anterior thalamic nuclei, the cingulate, the hippocampus, and all its interconnections. So let's look at both of them now. So this is the paper that we wrote, analysis of the papace circuit and adjoining limbic system by fiber dissection techniques. And believe me, this is one of the first of its kind, and it is highly cited, not by neurosurgeons, but by many neurologists and neuropsychiatrists. So let's begin. How do you begin fiber dissection? First, you have formalin fixed and frozen brains, and you use the Klingler's method for dissection. The tools that we use were basically ice cream spoons. If you have ice cream candy and you take out the wooden spoon and you just shape it in the way that you want, you can have various tips, various sizes to whatever. If you want to make it thin, you can make it thin. If you want it a bit rougher and thicker, you can do that. So basically they are handmade thin wooden and curved metallic spatulas. For the limbic system, you start dissection from the medial aspect of the hemisphere. So this is a picture we are all very familiar with. As you can see that I have cut the specimen a little, taking a part of the corpus callosum towards my side. So it is kind of projecting on the screen. This is the magnificent corpus callosum. You can see the rostrum, the genu, the body, and the splenium. The ependyma of the thalamus and the hypothalamus has still been retained. So what are the components of the limbic system? Before I start into individually going into each of them, I'll just note them down for you. So the gray matter constituents are the hippocampal formation, the amygdala, the hypothalamus, the nucleus accumbens, the cingulate cortex, areas of prefrontal cortex, and some nuclei of the midbrain. And the white matter components of the limbic system are the cingulum, the medial and lateral longitudinal striae, the fornix, the anterior commissure, the mammalothalamic and mammalotegmental tracts, the striae terminalis, the dorsal longitudinal fasciculus, medial forebrain bundle, and you also have the fascial or retroflexes. So let's begin. This is the superior surface of the hemisphere. This is the superior aspect of the corpus callosum. You can see a thin layer running over the corpus callosum. Here you can see it. This is a thin layer of gray matter, and it is called as the inducium tricium. Now, what is this inducium tricium? When you have the portion of the subsplenial gyrus or the fasciolar gyrus, when the dentate gyrus moves up, it becomes a thin layer of gray matter. It is supposed to be a vestigial, but it has some connections, and it runs all over the surface of the corpus callosum and ends in the subcallosal region over here. Within this inducium tricium, there are two thin myelinated bundles. You can see one of them here. These are the medial and the lateral longitudinal striae of Lancisi. Here you can see the transverse running fibers of the corpus callosum, and these are the longitudinal striae. These connect again directly the hippocampus to the subcallosal region. This is a pathway that goes from above the corpus callosum and goes and connects right below the rostrum of the corpus callosum. So this is the medial aspect of the hemisphere again. Now you can identify most of the structures in this region. This is the corpus callosum. This structure here that is projecting outside is the anterior commissure. This whole structure here, F, is the fornix. These are the columns of the fornix and the body of the fornix. This is the region of the thalamus. This is the choroid plexor running in the choroidal fissure. And what is the choroidal fissure? The choroidal fissure is a C-shaped structure that again runs between the frontal and the temporal planes. And it is running between the fornix superiorly and the thalamus inferiorly. So this is another C-shaped. All these structures become C-shaped because the temporal lobe develops in an inferior direction and it pulls all these structures down. So all this, the cingulum, the fornix, the choroidal fissure, the hippocampal fissure, all of them become C-shaped as they get dragged into the temporal lobe. So let's pursue our dissection further. What I did initially was started in the region of the thalamus. The thalamus has been cored out here, parts of the thalamus. The roof is still here. What you start seeing here is a tract. So what is this tract? You see the mammillary body here. And this is the tract that goes from the mammillary body to the anterior nucleus of the thalamus. This is the mammillothalamic tract of Vigtyazar. This is one of the most important constituents of the limbic system. There is another tract that runs from the mammillary body downwards into the midbrain. And it goes to the tegmental nuclei of Gudin into the midbrain. And this is the mammillotegmental tract. So this is the limbic connection that goes into the midbrain. That is how the limbic system communicates with the brainstem. So this is one of the major tracts that helps doing that. There are a couple of more, which I will discuss later. This structure here is the anterior commissure. Now this A and B regions here, this one is the paraterminal gyrus and this is the subcallosal gyrus. Why are these important? You have heard of the term septum. You are very familiar with septum pellucidum. And people confuse the term septal nuclei with septum pellucidum, thinking that the septum pellucidum has some nuclei. The septal nuclei are actually nuclei that are present on the depth in this region. When you remove the gray matter of the cortex and also the underlying white fibers, the nuclei that are present in the depth here are the septal nuclei, and they play a very important role in the limbic system, connecting the frontal and the temporal brains. We will see it later. So again, to revise, this is the fornix, this is the choroidal fissure, this is the thalamus, this is the anterior nucleus of thalamus, this is the mammillothalamic tract, the mammillary body, and this structure here is the caudate nucleus. From the previous image, you can see the ependyma of the lateral ventricle, which was present here covering the caudate, that has been removed, and now you can see the head of the caudate nucleus quite clearly. This region here is the uncus, and this is the parahippocampal gyrus. So these are the other important constituents of the limbic system. Now let's start with the cingulum. So what we do is we remove the gray matter of the cingulate cortex all around. And now, as I said, the limbic system is a series of C's. It is very clear here. So this is the first C. You have the cingulum going here. Then you have the corpus callosum, that is the second C. Then you have the fornix that is coming down, that is the third C. Then you have the choroidal fissure that is running, and that is the fourth C. And there is another one here. There is a fiber that runs from the between the caudate head and the thalamus. It runs all the way from here down to the amygdala. And that is the striae terminalis. As I was just saying, the one that controls all your emotions. So let's begin with the cingulum. The cingulum begins here in the subcallosal region, goes, follows the curve of the corpus callosum, goes superiorly, turns at the splenium downwards. This region is called the isthmus of the cingulum, and it goes and ends in the parahippocampal and entorhinal region. This end here is known as the radiation of the cingulum. So this is the course of the cingulum. And the cingulum has connections with the frontal and the parietal cortex. So this is one of the connections that has been dissected here. You can see that the cingulum is connecting to the parietal cortex. It also has a very prominent connection, which I will show in a later image, to the frontal lobe. So this is the component, main component of the limbic system, that is the cingulum. The other structures we have already seen. So this is another image of the cingulum. As you can see, it is beginning here in the subcallosal region. This is its frontal connection. This is its parietal connection. This is it running, the cingulum running over the corpus callosum right downwards into the temporal lobe. I'm not sure if you can appreciate.
I'll get that. It's a bleeder for me.
Okay, did you get it?
Okay, got it.
Okay, you got it. You coagulated it, huh?
Yes, I did.
So you can see this structure here, this thin white thing here. That is what we were talking about earlier, the striae terminalis. It has the bed nucleus of the striae that lies here, right lateral to the fornix here, between the caudate and the thalamus. And that connects all the way the septal region to the amygdaloid nuclei. So this is again a closer view of the same thing. You have seen these structures, just to revise: mammillary body, mammillothalamic tract, columns of fornix. And this is the radiation of the cingulum more clearly depicted now as it is ending into the parahippocampal area and the entorhinal area. This structure is the uncus. So we've seen the cingulum. We've seen, and now let's go into the hippocampus. So the hippocampus, actually it is hippocampal formation. It is made up of, it constitutes the hippocampus, it constitutes the subiculum and the fimbria. So what are the parts of the hippocampus? You have the head of the hippocampus, you have the body, you have the tail. And then over the hippocampus, you have a thin layer here. This is the alveus, which forms the fimbriae and continues ahead as the crura of the fornix, and then the body of the fornix and the columns of the fornix, and finally ends in the mammillary body. So why is the hippocampus, it looks like a seahorse, and it derives its name from there. And that's how it, you know, it has its paws there, and it's actually called a spes hippocampus. And you can see these paws here quite nicely. So what happens? Okay, as you see,
can you please repeat the previous slide?
This portion? This is the hippocampal head.
Yes.
This is the hippocampal head. This is the body of the hippocampus. And this thin thing here, turning and ending here, is the tail of the hippocampus. This layer here is the alveus. This layer here, alveus. It forms a thin fiber, white fiber layer called the fimbria. The fimbria go upwards and they form the fornix. These are the crura of the fornix, the body of the fornix, and the columns of the fornix. So the fornix is basically the main efferent pathway of the hippocampus. So all your connections, limbic connections, they are going to begin from parts of the hippocampus and the surrounding area, and then they are going to be carried forward through the fornix. Did you get that?
Thank you very much.
Okay. So now let's again look into, dissect into this region, and let's get to know the anatomy. So the medial aspect of the brain again. Now this whole region here is the parahippocampus. The parahippocampus is divided by this calcarine sulcus into one portion that goes up as the isthmus of the cingulum, as you have seen earlier, and continues as the cingulate gyrus, and one that continues posteriorly as the lingual gyrus. So this is the posterior connections of the parahippocampal gyrus. Now, as you go anteriorly, now what happens is there is a choroidal fissure. Above that, you have a hippocampal fissure. The whole parahippocampal gyrus, this region here, turns inwards. Okay, just be with me here. It turns inwards. When it turns inwards, this edge that it turns into is the subiculum. This is the subiculum here. So this parahippocampus turning into the subiculum. When it turns further, that is where the hippocampus is formed. So the medial aspect of the parahippocampus is the hippocampus formation. So let's see it ahead. As you can see now, the parahippocampus, the gray of the parahippocampus gyrus has been removed. Here you can see that the cingulum, the radiation of the cingulum that has come down here and ended into the entorhinal area here and the parahippocampus. Now this is the parahippocampal region that has turned, and you can see the head of the hippocampus that is come into view now. This region is the hippocampus. So you have the parahippocampus, it turns medially to form the hippocampus. The region where the parahippocampus and the hippocampus are separated by is the subiculum. That is the superiormost edge of the parahippocampal gyrus. So now when you see the hippocampal formation, hippocampus in this region, now you start seeing the fimbria here, as I showed you in the previous image. So you see the fimbria here going in the choroidal fissure. This black thing here is the choroidal fissure. This is the thalamus. This is the fornix. The fimbria going up and forming the fornix here. These are the crura of the fornix. This is the body of the fornix. These are the columns of the fornix. And you have them right here behind the anterior commissure. This is the mammillary body, the mammillothalamic tract, and the anterior nucleus of the thalamus. So now we have started going into the region of the Pape's circuit. Some constituents, some components I've already shown. Now let's go further. So now you see the dentate. Okay, I forgot to show you this. This structure here, this denticulated area. Can you see that? That's the dentate gyrus. So that is the that comes even more lateral to the hippocampal formation. It comes here, it runs here, goes above here beneath the corpus callosum as forms the subspinal gyrus, and then goes and runs above the corpus callosum as the inducium griseum, which I showed you in the first image. That is the thin layer of gray matter that is running over the corpus callosum. So as I was saying earlier, you have a choroidal fissure here, and above this, embryologically, we have the hippocampal fissure. What happens in the hippocampal fissure is parts of it develop very well, parts of it do not develop well. You have the hippocampus as a very big prominence in this region, and then you can see that it thins out here where that in the tail region, and then it is taken over by the fornix, and also some part of the hippocampal commissure is ridden over by the fibers of the corpus callosum. So that's why you have the inducium griseum here that gets separated out. It goes, the corpus callosum kind of separates the inducium griseum and the fornix by invading into the hippocampal commissure. So that's why you have a portion of the inducium griseum above the corpus callosum and a portion of the fornix and the hippocampal formation below the corpus callosum. So now I've removed the dentate gyrus here, and you can see the whole system. See, this is the hippocampus, this is the fimbria, this is the fornix running around and ending in the mammillary body and going into the anterior nucleus of the thalamus. Now the fornix, this is the main efferent pathway of the limbic system. What happens to it? It divides into two. It divides into a pre-commissural fornix and a post-commissural fornix. The one that connects to the mammillary body is predominantly the post-commissural fornix. The pre-commissural fornix is very small, and you mostly cannot see it. I haven't been able to dissect it grossly, and literature also says that it's very difficult to dissect it grossly. So it, what happens with that pre-commissural fornix is it gives out some fibers to the septal nuclei, whereas most of this goes to the mammillary body. Also, it gives some independent fibers to the anterior nucleus of the thalamus. So you have an alternate channel here. Something happens here. There is still a possibility of some fibers from the fornix that run directly into the anterior nucleus of the thalamus. That is the beauty of our brains. So now we have got most of the components of the Papage circuit. Now I will just come to the final portion here of the Papage circuit, not the limbic system. So what we have done here now is cut the anterior half of the corpus callosum. As you saw earlier, this is the cingulum, this is the fornix, this is the anterior commissure. So the caudate head has come into view. What we do now is we lift the caudate head. You lift the caudate head, the whole gray nuclei of the caudate head is lifted out by a metal spatula, and you start seeing some fiber bundles here. What are these fiber bundles? These are the anterior thalamic radiations. These are the ultimate connections of the limbic system. So you see them here more clearly. This is the anterior nucleus of the thalamus, and these are the fibers that are coming from the thalamus and going up and connecting to the cingulum. They intermingle with the fibers of the anterior limb of the internal capsule. So if you see from medially, you will see anterior thalamic radiations. If you see the same thing from the lateral aspect, you will see them as the anterior limb of the internal capsule. So these are the basic connections that connect this whole component of the limbic system to the cingulum. Going ahead, now you can see that the whole Papage circuit has been dissected out. I will show you the circuit. It starts and ends at the hippocampus. So this is the hippocampus, the fimbria, the fornix, the crura, the body, the columns of the fornix, the mammillary body, the mammillothalamic tract, the anterior nucleus of the thalamus, the anterior thalamic radiation, going to the cingulum turns all around and comes back as the radiation of the cingulum to end in the parahippocampus, entorhinal regia, and the hippocampus. So this forms the entire Papage circuit. This is the Papage circuit as we know it. And as you see that the Papage circuit also has connections to the cortex, which we already saw earlier. So you can see the parietal connection. It also has some frontal connections. So the whole system is elaborately connected to the whole cerebral neocortex and to the cerebral hemispheres. So what we did later in the spur of the moment is we dissected the whole Papage circuit outside. We took it outside the brain by dissecting it individually. And I'll show you again. So you have the hippocampus that is here. It is forming the fornix going into the mammillary body, mammillothalamic tract, anterior nucleus of the thalamus, the anterior thalamic radiations, and going into the cingulum and coming back to end in the region of the hippocampus. These are the cortical connections. And this component of the limbic system we have yet to discuss. This is the olfactory tract and the medial and lateral olfactory tri. Now let's look at the next component of the limbic system. So we are done with Papage circuit. That is one part of the limbic system. There are other components, and the basal forebrain forms another major component of the limbic system. So you have the olfactory tract dividing into the lateral and the medial olfactory striae. You can see here, what is this region here? This is the anterior perforated substance. These striae border the anterior perforated substance. What do these striae connect to? The lateral olfactory striae goes all the way here, goes into the piriform area, into the entorhinal cortex, and it connects with some amygdaloid nuclei. And what does the medial olfactory striae connect to? It goes to the subcallosal region here. It goes this way into the subcallosal region, which we saw in the medial aspect, and it connects to the septal nuclei. So this is another image where you can see that the olfactory striae, the medial and the lateral, this white structure that has started coming into the picture in the depth is the anterior commissure here. This is the third ventricle. You can see the choroid plexus in that region. This is the gyrus rectus. And now this basal dissection has dissected the whole anterior commissure. Now you can see the anterior commissure in its entire extent. So like a true commissure, it connects both the cerebral hemispheres, and it is a very basic connection of the limbic system. It connects both the temporal lobes to each other. I will show you how. It connects both the frontal lobes and both the temporal lobes to each other. First, to see the gross anatomy of the anterior commissure, it is a bow-shaped structure. You can see it very clearly. If you know, you're very familiar with the bow and arrow. So this is the bow of the anterior commissure. It has a frontal portion and a temporal portion. So this fibers that you see going ahead is the frontal portion. These fibers that you see going behind is the temporal portion. It is bordering here the third ventricle. You can see the choroid plexus here. And here, some part, here we have maintained some part of the cortex. Here, all the gray matter has been removed. And you can see these fibers here are the fibers of the internal capsule. And this gray structure here is the region of the basal nucleus of Meynert, the region of the substantia innominata. So this is the gray region here. And this region here is the region of the septal nuclei. So you can see how intricately connected all these fibers are to each other. And this is another interesting tract here, this D. That is the diagonal band of Broca that has connections with the septal nuclei and the amygdala. Now, mind you, the amygdala will come in this region. I will show you that later. And this is the fiber that connects it to that. So as I said, the temporal portion of the anterior commissure runs all the way into the lateral aspect of the temporal lobe. So this is what you see here. This is the anterior commissure running and going all the way. This is the temporal horn. This is the brain. This is the inferior aspect of the brain. You can see the optic tract, the peduncle. And this is the anterior commissure that we had dissected. And now it is going all the way into the temporal aspect of the brain. And you see it here on the lateral aspect. This is the anterior commissure that is coming from anteriorly. This is the region of the internal capsule. Just to show you, the globus pallidus has been removed here. This is the region where the globus pallidus will come. And just underneath and beneath it, the anterior commissure will run and run all the way here and form a layer in front of the optic radiations. So this part is actually the sagittal stratum. It consists of three layers. You have the IFOF, that's the first one, the inferior frontal occipital fasciculus. Then you have the temporal fibers of the anterior commissure. And then beneath that, you have the Meyer's loop of the optic radiation. So this is how the anterior commissure connects both the temporal lobes and both the frontal lobes. So you saw the frontal connections here. This is how the anterior olfactory nucleus is connected to the anterior olfactory nucleus on this side. And here you can see that, if you can imagine, the temporal lobe of both the sides are connected by this fiber bundle that runs across to the other side. This is the anterior commissure. So let's get back to this, the medial aspect, so that I can show you the other components, the medial aspect of the hemisphere. So now this is the region of the uncus and the parahippocampal gyrus. This is the mammillotegmental tract. I think I already discussed this. So again, just to have a short revision, this is the fornix, the choroidal fissure, the thalamus, the hippocampus, the fimbria going up, the dentate gyrus going above the corpus callosum. And this is the end of the radiation of the cingulum here. Now let's look at the inferior aspect. So this is the inferior part of the brain. You have the parahippocampal gyrus here. You have the fusiform gyrus here. And this is the inferior temporal gyrus. So the parahippocampal gyrus, and this is the region of the uncus. As you can see, it is very close to the cerebral peduncle here. And this is the parahippocampal gyrus. This is the rhinal sulcus. And this whole region here is the entrorhinal area. This is a closer view when we are doing epilepsy surgery. This is the anatomy that is important at that time. Your cerebral peduncle comes in the picture because you're going to go all the way till the pia in this region. You're going to remove all this area here. And you have to remember that this is the artery that will be just underneath the pia. You can see the PCA here beautifully. And this is the cerebral peduncle. If you damage either of this, you're going to be in big trouble. So what happens when we start dissecting here? Now I've removed the gray matter of the parahippocampus and the uncus. You see the optic tract here. This fiber, thin fibers that you see here, are the radiation of the cingulum as it is culminating in the inferior aspect of the parahippocampal gyrus. You remove the cingulum. See, you can see the fibers more clearly now. These are the radiation of the cingulum fibers. Very clearly you can see these fibers. You remove this, and the next layer that you see is the ependyme of the temporal horn. These are the radiation of the cingulum. Some fibers have been removed. This is the ependyma of the temporal horn. You remove the ependyma and you see the hippocampus in all its glory. Again, you see the head of the hippocampus, the body, and the tail. This is the temporal horn. This is the choroid plexus in the temporal horn. And this gray matter here is the amygdala and the amygdaloid nucleus. So now you can imagine how closely linked all these structures here. So this is the region, if you superimpose your gray matter over this, you have the region of the uncus here. You can see how the uncus actually envelopes the whole amygdala. It lies in the confines of the uncus, the amygdala. And the amygdala is called the amygdala because of its almond shape. Amygdala means almond. So this is the amygdala, and this is the region that is important for you while doing an amygdalo-hippocampectomy. I will go into that also. I will show you some dissected specimens for that. So this dissection has been shown to show you the Mayer's loop. So the hippocampus has been disconnected and pushed downwards. Then the choroid plexus can be seen. The choroid plexus is then reflected downwards again. And you see fibers beginning here. You can see these fibers here. So if you come from here, this is the optic tract. This is the lateral geniculate body region. And then you have fibers beginning from here. You can see these fibers that are running into the lateral aspect and the roof of the temporal horn. And this is the Mayer's loop of the optic radiations. Here you can see them more clearly as they are running from the lateral geniculate body on the roof and the lateral wall of the temporal horn. And you can see them here in this specimen, as I showed you earlier. These are the, this is the Mayer's loop of the optic radiation, and the posterior part is the middle and the posterior portion of the optic radiation. This whole region is the internal capsule. You have the anterior limb. Just medial to that will be the anterior thalamic radiation. So you have the anterior limb, the genu, the posterior limb, the retrolenticular portion, and the sublenticular portion of the internal capsule in all its glory. This is the anterior commissure. So let's get back to this region, the hippocampus and the fornix. So we saw this structure already. Now what happens when you see it on both the sides? What happens is both the fornices come together here. They come very close here near the body of the fornix, and then they go down and form the columns of the fornix. This region here is connected by a series of fibers that is called the hippocampal commissure. And beneath, beyond that, you will have the posterior commissure and the habenular commissure. So these are the other important components of the limbic system, which if you damage, you're going to have memory disturbances. So now talking about amygdala hippocampectomy, let me just go into the anatomy of that to make it clear for you. So this is your lateral aspect of the temporal lobe. You start making a corticectomy in this region. You start making a corticectomy in the middle temporal gyrus. This is where you will start. And then you start seeing the hippocampus here. Here you can see it beautifully. This is the head of the hippocampus. This is the body of the hippocampus. And this is the tail of the hippocampus. The superior temporal lobe is absolutely preserved. There is no problem. You are in the middle temporal gyrus and portion of the inferior temporal gyrus. You can see the temporal horn and the hippocampus. This is a coronal view showing the head of the hippocampus. As I said, pes hippocampi, like the paws of a cat. This looks like the paws of a cat. This is called pes hippocampi. Now this image shows you various relations of the limbic system in particular. These are the relations in the depth. So this you're familiar with. This is the hippocampus now. This is another thing you're familiar with, the olfactory tract. I said the medial part of the olfactory tract connects to the amygdaloid nuclei. So this region here is the amygdala. Mind you, if you take an incision very close to the amygdala, you will reach this region, that is the globus pallidus, which you don't want to do. This is, they have a very thin line of demarcation between the amygdala and the globus pallidus. So it is very important in epilepsy surgery to be aware of this demarcation and not cross it. So let's look at this. This is the IFOF. I told you about the sagittal stratum in this region. This is the IFOF. Here you cannot see the anterior commissure yet. You can see some part of the internal capsule. The anterior commissure is just beneath it. And this is the optic radiation. What structure you will have beneath it? As I said, it will run in the roof and the lateral wall of the temporal horn. So this structure beneath it, once I turn the specimen, you will see it clearly. This is the hippocampus. So that is why you have your pie in the sky deficit when you do an amygdala hippocampectomy. If you cross this, if you're going to go in the roof, you're going to go in the posterior in the lateral wall of the temporal horn, you're going to cause a visual deficit. And basically, you try to enter the hippocampus and the temporal horn in the anterior aspect, because here it is devoid of fibers and you will have a less chance of injury. And if you look in the depth, here you can see that this is the optic radiation. The hippocampus is deflected down. This region here on the lateral aspect of the temporal lobe is the safest way to enter for a amygdala hippocampectomy when coming from the lateral surface. Now, just to show you the image in a how you see it intraoperatively. So this is how you will see the brain. This is the superior temporal gyrus. This is the middle temporal gyrus here. So you start making a corticectomy in this region and you will start seeing the hippocampus here. This is the region of your amygdala. This is your hippocampus. This is your amygdala. Sorry, ma'am. So while doing your amygdala hippocampectomy, this is the entire region along with, if you're not doing a selective amygdala hippocampectomy, this is the whole region that will come out. This is the whole area that is generally removed for an epilepsy surgery. So here, the head of the hippocampus and the amygdala have a very close relation. And that's where you make the cut. So you can see it here, as I showed you in this image. This is the amygdala. This is the hippocampus. This is your temporal horn. So if you cut here near the tail and you cut here just at the roof of the amygdala, you will avoid injury to the globus pallidus. And then you dissect medially and maintain your pia, and you will not damage the medial surface of the, go to the cerebral peduncle or the PC. Again, you should remember that the internal capsule has a very close relation. This is the Mayer's loop. As I said earlier, if you enter in this region, you can see here the Mayer's loop of the optic radiation here. Here, it is devoid. There is nothing here. So if you enter here and continue dissection in this direction, you will not damage the Mayer's loop. So to summarize, these are your various connections of the limbic system as we have seen them. So let's start here. This is the subiculum, as I told you. The parahippocampus turns, and then there is a subiculum. This entorhinal cortex, as I showed you, has connections to the subiculum by two pathways. This is the alveolar pathway and the perforant pathway. And then the subiculum's main efferent is the fornix, which goes and ends in the mammillary body. Here in the lateral, mainly it ends in the medial mammillary nuclei, which forms the mammillothalamic tract, which goes to the anterior thalamic nucleus, anterior thalamic radiations, the cingulate gyrus, then the cingulum, back into the parahippocampal gyrus, and the entorhinal cortex. So these are the major limbic connections of the hemisphere. You also have some limbic connections between the telencephalon, diencephalon, and mesencephalon. So these are the striae medullaris. This connects the septal nuclei to the habenular nuclei that are present in the posterior aspect of the thalamus. You have the fasciculus retroflexus that connects the habenular nuclei to the midbrain. And you have the medial forebrain bundle, which connects the septum and the preoptic region to the tegmental nuclei of the midbrain. So to end, this is again the model of the Papish circuit, which we have reconstructed outside from the brain. And thank you very much.
Very good. Thank you very much, Dr. Shah. Okay, comments or questions from the audience?
Hello, ma'am.
Go ahead.
John, can you stop screen share?
Yeah, sure. Okay.
Excellent lecture, Abhida. Very good lecture.
Thank you.
Proud
of you, man.
There you go.
Hello, ma'am.
You should have more of these lectures. I was supposed to be going out. My kids are outside in the car, but I just waited because it was so beautiful presentation. So
thank you
very much once more. We had a great day today. After I bored everybody with slowness.
No, your videos were great. I mean, they should understand that the technique is beautiful and the aneurysms you showed were great.
Okay, yes. Floor's open. Floor's open. Go ahead.
See you, Dad.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead. Go ahead.
More of you presentations from you.
Yeah. Hello. Yeah, we do that.
Hello, Abhida ma'am.
Go ahead.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Dr. Nilay here.
Yes, Nilay, tell me.
So I was looking for this since last 1.5 years when I was there at KEM. So okay. Got the chance today.
Okay. Finally.
Yes, finally. Now, can you please show those slides again where you are showing left-sided amygdala hippocampectomy on brain specimen? Just one or two slides.
Okay, John, should I screen share again?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, just a minute.
So what I'm looking for is the relation of choroid plexus and hippocampal head.
Okay, just a minute. It's just behind it. I'll show you.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. See, this is the head of the hippocampus. This is where your choroidal artery will enter. This is the choroidal point, and this is the choroid plexus here. So it is devoid here. Your choroid plexus will start a little posteriorly. This is your hippocampal head. Did you get that? I can't hear you, Nilay.
Yes, yes, ma'am. I'm getting that.
Okay.
Okay. So once while doing this, I damaged the anterior choroidal. Disaster okay. Again. I know that. Oh, fine. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Nilay.
You know, I couldn't agree with you more. This has been a fantastic presentation, and thank you very much for such a lucid lecture. I truly appreciate it. For those of us digging deep into epilepsy lecture, epilepsy surgery, we have to review this frequently and then be mindful of where to and where not to. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Kanam.
Thank you, Dr. Kanam.
Hello, ma'am.
Go ahead.
Two points. Once you say diagonal band of Broca, and after that, there were three relations like IFOF.
Yeah. Nila, I can't hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Hello.
Go ahead.
Am I audible now?
Yes,
audible. Yes.
Okay. So, 2 points, diagonal band of Broca. And then you talked about IFOF, three things, IFOF, temporal part of anterior commissure and Mayer's.
Yeah.
That slide I want to look again, ma'am, please.
I'll explain to you. I will show you the slide later. See, okay, what fine. Happens is, sagittal stratum is a series, stratum means a series of layers. Hmm. It is a series of three layers. The first layer is the IFOF.
It's called sagittal stratum.
Yes, it's called sagittal stratum.
Fine,
the first layer is the IFOF. Beneath it, you have fibers, the temporal fibers of the anterior commissure. And beneath that, you have the optic radiations. This is these are three fibers. The diagonal band of Broca is completely away from them.
Yes. Huh.
This will be in the lateral aspect of the temporal lobe. Your diagonal band of Broca is on your inferior, medial and basal aspect. It is your forebrain bundle. It is connecting your forebrain to the amygdala.
Fine.
And this is connecting the temporals.
Fine. And madam, a relation of anterior commissure to third ventricle.
It's just in front of the third ventricle. I showed you that.
So superiorly or?
Anterior, just anterior.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, more comments, questions? There's a lot of people in here. Dr. Shah, more than 80 people. Go ahead.
Thank you, Dr. Shah, for this great presentation, clear from scratch to details. I don't have any comments or questions. I just have a request. Would you please arrange for more anatomy presentations in the near future, please?
Yes, we'll try to organize.
Yeah, sure. There seems to be a lot of interest.
Yes.
Hello.
Go ahead.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm Dr. Sarwar. From the new surgery resident, Kolkata, in Kolkata, first year of 3 year new surgery resident. Ma'am, it was, I must congratulate you. This is a very, very helpful lecture. And I'll hope for many more similar lectures.
Thank you very much.
And John, I will request you that please, can you upload this on the new surgical TV? YouTube channel.
Yes, they're all automatically put on the channel.
It will be very much helpful for the study.
Okay, I put the link in the chat box of the YouTube channel. I'll put it in again. Okay, the YouTube link that you subscribe to.
Thank you, ma'am. Once again.
Okay.
Thank you. So basically, you should all, when you're doing neurosurgery, before you go into interaxial brain surgery, you should learn neuroanatomy because it gives you a very good three-dimensional perspective, and it keeps you very clear as to where you have to go and where you don't have to.
Definitely, man. But this kind of neuroanatomy dissection-wise, it is quite difficult.
You have to give time to it. It does not happen easily. It takes a lot of time.
Yes.
And
I have seen that.
Slowly and surely, but you will be able to.
Yes.
Thank you.
Hello.
Go ahead.
Yes. Yes.
Go ahead from Morocco. We're getting to know the people, Dr. Shah.
Yes.
Hello.
Go ahead from Morocco.
Thank you very much. Excellent, excellent lecture. Please, can you make some comment about awake surgery and the importance of these structures?
See, what is happening now is we haven't actually gone into the, no one has actually studied limbic system on awake surgery. Most of the structures are too deep. They don't even come in your way. What you come across is maybe the cingulum. Now, nobody monitors the cingulum. You cannot, because you do not monitor emotion during surgery. There is a lot of emotion already during play when a patient is undergoing an awake surgery. So it is difficult to monitor the limbic system, but maybe in the future, people will do it because it is going to be an important aspect. Because if you damage some component that is going to inhibit your emotion, you're not going to have a very great, you know, life. So maybe in the future, they will start monitoring this also. But not yet.
Thank you.
Not yet.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank
you. Hello, ma'am. Nilan here.
Yes.
So whole purpose of doing this wide fiber dissection is so whole purpose is to identify it as eloquent area, one more eloquent area, right?
No, you have to understand that just the cortex is not eloquent.
Yes.
White fibers are also eloquent. And you don't understand the anatomy till you do the dissection. That is the problem.
Okay.
Because the fibers are intermingled, till you start doing them, you will not understand the anatomy. That is
intraoperatively, is it possible to identify these fibers or?
You cannot see them as fibers. But once you know the anatomy, you will start realizing that this is the structure that is going to come in the way next. So you cannot identify them intraoperatively, but anatomically you will be able to identify. Nila, you're gone again. I can't hear you.
So since last 1.5 years, I've been trying to look for these fibers intraoperatively while doing some other surgery like glioma or whatever it may be. So I have not been able to identify them.
You cannot identify. You cannot. There is no way you can identify. Maybe, you know, fornix you can identify. Maybe, you know, some major fiber bundles you can identify, but otherwise, no.
Okay. Fine.
Okay. More questions, comments? Just jump in. This is your chance. If you don't, you'll think about this the rest of the day. Right, Dr. Shah?
Yes, John.
You won't be able to sleep. Okay, I guess we'll wrap it up, Dr. Shah, and we look forward to your next session. Okay. Do you have anything planned, or are you just going to think about it? Or
no, we'll think about it. We are all locked down, so as and when
okay.
We can do something.
Very good. Thank you. Well, I'll just wrap this up formally. Thank you, and thank you all the panelists for coming.
Come soon, madam.
We'll see you tomorrow.
Okay.
Thank you.